you'd like to showcase?
Just for fun.
Oh, one second. Sorry. Like, to be honest, the majority of it.
And you're like, hey, Anthony's doing this rustic one, he's not working, eh? With my food, I'd say, I'm actually very simple. I like clean meat lines. Very symmetrical stuff. Very symmetrical. Sometimes it's a little bit too much. The thing about food is your base ingredients never change. A steak will always be a steak. A piece of salmon will always be a piece of salmon. Asparagus will always be asparagus. It's what you do with it. It's the processes you take it through. Okay. And I think that's where the difference between a cook and a chef comes in, because the cook will just blanch the asparagus and serve it to you, yeah, with some salt on the table. But when you're having asparagus, I want you to think, hey, I've never had asparagus like this. Is it Graze? Is it John? Or is it the asparagus? I want you to question what you put in your mouth. Not because it's bad, but because it's so amazing experience. So I learned my trade on the job. That's the thing, I've never been to culinary school. When you enter the kitchen, you have no respect. Nobody respects you. So you start with all the... what's the correct word? I'd have to swear to describe this. Those jobs, okay? So learning all of those, you know, how to peel garlic quickly and the basics. It would have been added advantage if I'd gone to college. But that would have also been 2 years that I've lost in a formal kitchen. So I'd say the biggest challenge was knowing names of things, understanding what. When you send for a Parisian scoop, I mean, what's a Parisian scoop? I mean, you've just come from school. So things like those. And then I was still technically a kid, and everybody else in the kitchen was mature. So you learn quickly, you grow up quickly. Gaining the respect in the kitchen is, it's simple. It's just your work ethic. My interpretation of cooking at home and what we do in the hotel is two very different things. So entering a formal kitchen and actually, my impression was like, everything is cooked in a big pot. When you come, it's all served. So that's what I thought it was gonna be about. So, I mean, like right now, I'd say 50% of my day is just spent managing people, signing stuff, doing things, and the other 50 is cooking. You work hard, work your balls off, of course, and you answer the correct answers. It's either yes chef or no chef. Those are the answers they want to hear at that time. So that's really how you start. And then, slowly, I mean, when you ask for this, you deliver. And you, as you deliver, you kind of, you give it more and more challenges. The goalposts keep on shifting. And each time you reach the next goal, it moves. Being a Kenyan chef, you have to work twice as hard. All these great places, yeah? So what do they have to compare to here? Okay, what do they have to compare? They get all your guests international, whether they're local Kenyans or whether they're expatriates. Or these guys have the financial muscle to go wherever. They can go to Paris, they can go to London, they can go to New York. So the quality they expect in New York is the quality they expect here. Okay? So there's no excuses. You can't be like, oh, it's Kenya or anything like that. Oh, I'm Kenyan. So you have to work twice as hard to get their experience that they have there in New York, London, Paris, to come in, translate these dishes to get them to the same level here. Also, your ingredients list, your products list is much smaller here, which is quite ironic because a lot of things we grow here and then export straight. We as Kenyans do not use them as much. Okay, you put a beetroot for a guy on a plate, he goes, what's this purple thing? Plus my signature moussik cheese that Browns makes for me. The whole concept here is, one, you still feel like you're in New York, but you still also know you're in Kenya. It's a typical New York steakhouse. And the whole idea is to, you know, to give the diner a different experience. The diner who's never maybe been to New York, and he can experience that here. I honestly don't have a favorite cut of meat. I would say it depends on my mood. Fat is flavor. In most cases, I go for a ribeye. In most cases, I go for a ribeye. But that's if my guys are cooking. At home, hot searing pan. If you have a thick pan, that would be ideal. That really hot, a little bit of oil on the meat, not in the pan. On the meat, then put the meat in the pan. I'd say, depending on now what you're using, if you're using an electric stove or gas cooker, I'd say about 4 to 5 minutes on each side. Then you need to let it rest just 2 minutes. If you put the oil in the pan, the oil will burn. Then it gets that, it's not a smoky flavor, it's, I'd say, greasy flavor, a greasy burnt flavor is what you get. Yeah. First thing for me, I come in, I do my rounds. Okay, say hi to everybody, check everybody's okay. It's really important because you're only as good as your weakest team player. So if somebody's not having a good day, you need to know what's going on. So then into the restaurant, see what's happening. Of course, the night before, always know what the occupancy is. All right. Then after that, I go check my emails. Yes, we do have computers in the kitchen. And then sort of like go through the ordering, go through what's planned for the day. Because most executive chefs, we have multiple outlets, so there's always something going on in some different place and all of that. So you have to check the functions, you have to check if you've got any deliveries, if you've got your stocks right. Okay, you also have to check how much revenue you made the night before, because at the end of the day it's all a business. Any executive chef has to have really, really good sous chefs. Okay, now a sous chef is me when I'm not there. You have to set up the kitchen in a way you have systems and processes. So if it gets to the stage where I'm touching a pan, it means things have gone really, 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 really wrong, or I'm teaching them something new. I can remember I won the Chain de Rotier competition, and that was out of this world, because I was still actually training. I'd not yet been formally employed by them. So winning that and actually coming first in the country was like amazing. I mean, it was crazy feeling, best thing ever. The thing about being a chef is you never stop learning. You never stop learning. So it's always, and the good thing about food, that's why I think I'm in the best industry in the world, food always evolves, okay? It's always something trendy, it's always something new, it's always somebody on the corner of the street doing something better than you, you know, thinking in a different way. So that's the thing, I still want to learn a lot more, yeah? I want to, you know, continue growing, and well, eventually, other than having Graze, it'll be John. No, hopefully, one John. Day. And you always have to keep pushing yourself. Nobody will push you. Nobody will push you. I would say my favorite food is actually something I've not cooked. So, as you're saying, after a busy day, go home, and it's something the wife has cooked, that'll be amazing. As much as it was hard, I felt right at home. And even now, I'm most comfortable. Even when I go for a party, I end up in the kitchen. My mom's pilau, I mean, I can never recreate that. With all my experience, I can never recreate what she does. She does this matoke dish, I mean, I don't even try that. I just eat it and I'm not even going to try cook that. So, for me, that's the best part. Even about going to visit my mom, is I'll always get there and she's cooked. So all I do is eat.